Welcome everyone to the session on renunciation of mass cyber attacks. My name is Raik Yakshis, and I'm a member of the Cybersecurity Center of the Federal Armed Forces of Germany. So we will, as you might have noticed in the recent years and decades, the media coverage has gone up about cyber attacks, and we see the space advancing in that field, with the media covering it more and more. But most of those attacks were successful or failed, and most of them actually weren't hidden in the case that they were actually seen. In this session, we will start focusing first on the botnet activities and the capacity of what those botnets can do before we actually tackle the main topic of this conference, the silent battle. And there, we will focus on hidden attacks and how they can be actually detected and faced. Starting out, this, the whole session is structured the following way. We got 90 minutes and three panelists. Every panelist will have around about 22 minutes to bring the research across and actually or discuss their paper. And afterwards, we have a small time for like some questions. I would ask all of you to raise those questions and also the panelists to start discussing with each other, if possible. So we're going to start with Mr. Axel Wauer. He's going to be speaking about scalable offense, how botnets are used for cyber attacks. Alex holds a Master of Science in IT Security from the Technische Universität Darmstadt and is currently a PhD student at the University of Bonn. He works as a researcher in the Department of Cyber Defense and Analysis at Fraunhofer FKIE, where his research primarily revolves around botnets. In this capacity, he seeks to further the understanding of botnet monitoring and mitigation techniques in order to advance the methods applied in risk management in cyberspace. Apart from his research, Alex is engaged in teaching and cultivating young talent in the cybersecurity space. Alex, the stage is yours.
Thank you. So, hello, my name is Axel, and it's my And it's my first time at SciCon, and so like everyone else, I joined the keynote yesterday, and I liked the way they described cyberspace, and described it like cyberspace is where everyone pretends to be many, even if they are few. So, and this triggered me because I'm researching on botnets, and today I'm talking about scalable offense, how botnets are used for cyber attacks. To begin my talk, I want to share my personal definition of what is a botnet. A botnet is a network structure in cyberspace that can be remotely controlled by a third party. So if you have a phone, a smart car, your computer, iMac, which runs malicious software and can be controlled by a third person, then for me, it's a botnet. Based on this common sense of understanding what a botnet is, I will present you botnet basic and architectures, raising the question if there are enough vulnerable devices available or if botnet like an overhyped threat and not interesting anymore. And then later on, after solving this question, we go to attack types of botnets. So botnets basic. To build a botnet and have one, you need at least one infected system, which can be controlled by a third person. We call it bot or zombie. If you have more than one infected systems, you need a command and control server to control and share commands. The guy behind the command and control server is called bot master and bot header. And the main function of a botnet is to carry out commands. So, Having an infected machine, having a lot of infected machines, means they need to connect to the command and control server. So the simplest architecture you can see is a centralized architecture where the bots directly connect and get receive commands. The problem in this architecture yet is that taking down the CNC server, the botmaster will lose control over the whole botnet. So the architecture improved, and they added a second layer of proxies to increase resilience. So you can see, even if we take down one CNC server, the botmaster doesn't lose the whole botnet. He can still work with it. And another solution next to a centralized architecture is this decentralized architecture here, where you don't have a single point of failure by using a command and control server. You have the bots connecting directly peer-to-peer to each other. So you increase the network resilience, but you need to pay it with delay in sharing the commands. But now the bot master needs to connect to one bot, updating the command list, and needs to wait till the command is shared over the whole network. So as it is in cyberspace, if you have two solutions for one problem, there's always someone who makes it up. So we have hybrid architecture, where you have bots connected to each other and additional CNC server to increase the speed of updating commands. In my team, we separate bots in different botnet flavors, yeah, different kind of botnets. So we have the traditional botnet, which consists normally as clients from Windows or Linux servers, or we have a new kind of botnet, which is called IoT botnet, which consists of small resource restricted low energy devices, normally running with embedded software and Linux based, and this is like everything you can imagine around smart smart things, Internet of Things, like IP cameras, baby monitor, smart speakers, even vacuum cleaner robots are fitting in this category. Everything which has restricted resources and still connected to the internet. Another flavor are mobile botnets. Since 2007, the first iPhone, we have this problem. And mobile botnets consist out of phones, tablets, smartwatches, maybe in future also smart cars. So everything you can take with you. And then the next point is social bots. I'm a little bit struggling because in my team we are not researching social bots so much. They are related to a botnet, but they are mostly based on online accounts misusing, and their target is different. They try to manipulate public opinions and people, and not attacking other devices on the internet. And as always, there are mixed botnets, mixed of IoT botnet or traditional stuff. So having the basics, now we can raise the question, are there enough vulnerable devices available on the internet? And it's really hard to find numbers which can say, okay, we have this and this number of devices which can be hacked in future. So they are not reliable numbers, but we can make estimations on published numbers, like for example Android distributions. Here you see the Android operation systems and the market distribution of market caps, like published in August 2018, Android Pie, the newest version, already has 10% of the market. But also you see November 2014, Android Lollipop still has 12% of the market, even if it's 5 years old. Google published a message where they are saying, okay, they have 2 billion of active Android devices. So you can say, oh, maybe there's a threat if they do not provide security updates. But Google provides security updates even down to Android version 4.4. The problem is that not all of us, actually a minority of us, uses a clean Android version. All of us use customized versions. If you have LG, Motorola, Samsung, then you have always a customized Android version, and then you rely on the update politic of these companies. So the companies, in average, support their phones 1.5 or 2 years. If you're really lucky, 5 years, but in average, 2 years. So you see more than 50% of Android phones on the market connected to the internet theoretically can have outdated operation system. This means more than 1 billion phones. So yes, theoretically, there are enough devices on the market which can be misused for botnets. I want to present some concrete numbers, just to get a feeling from the past how huge botnets can be. The Suminru botnet, I always get stuck on this, appeared 2017 and could hijack 526,000 devices. This is a number based on thanks to the NSA Eternal Blue exploit. But it shows what can be possible. The IoT botnet even shows in a better way how the numbers are rising. Yeah, 2012, Aitra botnet hijacked 11,000 devices just by brute forcing the login credentials. Yeah, 2 years later, Bashlight hijacked 100,000 devices. Again, just brute forcing login credentials. And 2 years later, 2006, Mira appeared with 62 login credentials and hijacked 500,000 devices. So you see the threat is increasing. And to answer the question if there are enough devices on the internet to build botnets, then the sentence below the table is important here. In December 2017, a hacker called Energy managed to infect 18,000 routers in 24 hours. This actually shows how vulnerable the cyberspace is. And I think it proves that there are more than enough devices available for botnets. I just want to talk a little bit about botnet characteristics before we focus on the botnet attacks. So in general, setting up a botnet is not a targeted attack. Yeah, an adversary just tried to brute force login credentials or use a published exploit and scans the whole internet and takes what he get. So our bots are globally distributed, yeah, and executing a command in a botnet can scale from one simple client up to the whole botnet is executing this command. Just focusing on one bot in a botnet, the characteristic is interesting because each bot has the ability to use the internet, has bandwidth, it's even is able to store files, has processing power you can misuse, even power the energy use of the device you can control if you increase or decrease the calculations on the devices here. The availability on the devices depends on the type. Sometimes they always online, sometimes they just online for hours. And the devices are mostly in special networks and areas like home net, special protected networks, like home networks or company networks. So talking about attacks, the first attack is probably the most famous attack called DDoS, where you can use the whole power of each bot to restrict availability of a service. I do not talk too much about DDoS because another speaker is focusing on it. Yet I want to say that it's even possible to restrict functionality if you have an online service who relates on sensor data to work and you attack this sensor data, you probably can crash the whole service without attacking the service itself. Attack number two is sending spam. Yeah, normally the attack developed from sending commercials, yeah, and selling stuff. But using a botnet for spam, you can also run spear phishing attacks. So use trusted mail addresses and trust to attack other people. Attack number three possible with a botnet is identity theft, which means if you have a botnet and if you have malware on the clients, you are able to control the clients, you are able to steal credentials. And I'm not just talking about stealing Twitter credentials or YouTube or Facebook credentials. I'm just talking about stealing SSH keys or stealing LDAP credentials or VPN logging credentials. Another good example for identity theft is the Ghost DNS botnet, which was a router botnet infecting router and changing the DNS configuration. This way, an attacker was able to modify DNS queries and provide faked banking accounts or start man-in-the-middle attacks. Attack number four is called resource abuse. This attack focuses directly on the bot itself and shows what is possible. In general, if you just have a small bot like a smart speaker, or you don't have a lot of processing power, and you wouldn't do like cryptocurrency mining on the system. Yet in a botnet, you have a lot of processing power because you have a lot of devices, and then it's possible to do efficient cryptocurrency mining. And if you can do this, you can even do distributed password cracking as an attack if you don't have enough resources for yourself. An interesting idea for misusing resources in a botnet is the power consumption. So do complex calculation, raise power consumptions of the bot in a special area like Germany or Europe, and then reboot the systems. Yeah, so you get a spike in the power grid, which maybe or maybe not can break the power grid. If it doesn't work, try it again. Yeah, or combine it with other attacks. But that's ideas which are possible working. If you own a botnet, you can even proxy your communication through the whole botnet and hide your traces, making it very hard to do attribution where you're original from. Attack number five, pay per installation, actually is a targeted malware injection. So if you don't own a botnet, yeah, but you want to get access in a special area and you noticed, okay, there are already bots available in this IP range. Just contact the bot master and force him or bring him to install your malware. It's even a prepare install as a service and concept in cybercrime. So you can directly target individuals, countries, or industries. So you even can trigger different responsibilities by distributing malware in specific countries, specific areas. Attack number 6, click fraud. Original evolved from commercial abuse. Now botnets are used to manipulate online polls, and control public opinion, and also they can be used to fake interest by generating views on news pages, which is the main idea to use the botnet, query news pages and specific topics. The websites rely on the viewer of each report and will in future focus on other topics. So you're able to manipulate the output of news websites. Attack number 7, sabotage, which can be done with a botnet in huge scale, like software modification, system destruction, data manipulation. You can do a ransom, coordinated ransom encryption of bots and forcing creating panic and chaos, as we saw it in WannaCry some years ago. Another thing we saw is dropping backdoors. VPN filter infected a lot of router in the Ukraine, and even after taking down the whole communication channels, the devices are still infected and are possible to control based on the backdoor. Attack number 8, the last one in this line is reconnaissance, which means you are able to do global distributed cyberspace reconnaissance, which actually is a fancy word for distributed scanning, which allows you to document and scan special IP ranges or the whole internet, creating network history without revealing your identity. Focusing on one bot, even adding network sniffer or key logger on the bots, or automated systems for lateral movement are possible. I want to close my talk by mentioning metadata monitoring. If you infect mobile phones and you use sensor data you are able to track and monitor users even you are able to track and monitor users in a specific field. For example, if you infect a huge number of phones in a military base, you can analyze how they behave and what their daily routines are. So, closing was in conclusion. I think botnets are still rising threats. With a lot of possibilities. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Axel, for clearing what botnets are and what are the use cases. Do we have any questions? Yes. Do we have a microphone around? There's a gentleman in the middle.
Thank you. So, based on your research, what is your what do you think is the biggest botnet actually running? right now in the world, and what is the best way to find the victims on the infected victims?
So I cannot tell you what's the biggest botnet in the world, but there are
right now, like.
But you can find victims by analyzing the malicious software and setting up, for example, sinkholes, catching monitor the domains the bots want to connect, and then you can identify the bots and the victims in this way.
Any further questions? Well, right. Then I do have one for you. Axel, first of all, I'm sorry that I said Alex at the very beginning. Yeah. That's why I'm like, oop. You mentioned, I think, at the very beginning that mobile botnets are very common.
Yeah.
And you mentioned like the Android distribution throughout the phones, like which software versions we still use. And we heard, I think, yesterday and this morning about the 5G rollout and how it will influence future actions in the field. Can you give an example of like how will that play a role, like for botnets and the activity, and like maybe the span, how they react and how they can be used?
So. I think 5G will increase the problem with botnets because everything 5G is developed for connecting everything. Yeah, based on the current software quality we have, I assume that the number of bots are dramatically increasing. Yeah, because we get more and more devices which are online, more and more devices which are remote administrated, and so we will see more and more attacks on these devices, and in result, more and more bots, bigger
okay.
botnets.
Thank you very much. Let's give Axel another applause. Oh, there's another question, sorry. If we do have time for one more question, yeah, please.
Thank you for the presentation. I have a question related to botnets in IoT devices. You mentioned that in three different years, the cases of devices that has been infected depends on probably in default passwords, probably because devices came from China, or it's based on brute forcing. But what do you think that is the main reason that the number of devices controlled by a command and control, it's based on default password? I mean, the number, it's increasing year by year. What do you think that is the main reason?
The main reason for the number of bots is actually bad software quality, I think. So I just mentioned attacking them with default passwords, because it's like one of the easiest way showing that the attacker doesn't even need to use exploits to hijack devices. So if you increase software quality and force automatic software updates, I think we can mitigate the threat in an effective way.
Okay, thank you very much. So, since we have heard of the botnets, the capabilities, and like how they act in the cyberspace, our next speaker, Artur Lavrenov, is going to talk about towards measuring global DDoS attack capacity. So, I think attack number one you mentioned. To say something about Artus. Artus is a researcher at the NATO CCDTOE, focusing on the web and network technologies while teaching security courses, performing applied and academical research, and contributing to cyber exercises. Artus has taught web technology and IT security courses at the University of Latvia, where he's currently a PhD student performing research in the cybersecurity domain. Artus, We are waiting for your presentation.
Okay, thank you. And hello, and this is the topic last year that was announced at Silent Battles, but this year is 20 year anniversary of probably loudest type of cyber attacks, DOS attacks, and a reasonable observer would assume that somebody has done something to mitigate the issue. And if you look at different security issues we have had over the years, a lot of stuff gets fixed, and we are dealing with new stuff and fixing it. If you look at the DOS attacks, the issues that existed 20 years ago, it's existing in the same shape and form today. And because of the growing internet, growing technologies and connection speeds, attacks are actually getting worse, and it's still a problem, and so the question is why? And there are so many different answers, and Axel discussed software quality, of course, economical reasons, it's cheaper to make in China devices which have lower quality with default passwords than to make them in Europe following some security standards, of course, and legislative and political, a lot of answers, but not like a single concrete answer that would solve the issue. And there are different types of the DOS attacks, and Axel discussed botnets causing DOS, but there are two approaches. Either the traffic is directly coming from the botnet, or it's being reflected and amplified through some other devices. And it completely depends on the bot master, how the software is designed, and maybe bot can do both. But if you have small botnet, then the standard types of the attacks, like application, protocol, or network, will most likely fail if you do it directly. But if you have small botnet, and you try reflect attacks, you are highly likely to succeed. And what is the reason? The reason that there are a large number of the devices that actually produce the answer, which is significantly larger than the question. So, and because they are using UDP packets, so they are sending the answer without verifying the source. And it's quite hard to mitigate. So there are networks that allow it to happen, and there are a lot of these devices that support this. And if you have ever read anywhere about DOS attacks, you would see this picture. And I highly dislike these types of pictures because what we see some machines and some arrows. They don't really explain anything. And what I like to explain, simplified version, and so we have four networks. Oh, we have actually five, but we have four networks that matter. And the network number one, it's a good service provider. It does what it's supposed to be doing. It's filtering. It's forbidding IP spoofing. The provider number three, it doesn't do it. Why? Maybe they don't want to do it. Maybe they have no capability to do it. So anyone, any bot that is in that network can spoof the IP address of the packet. And of course, there is network two. In network two, there is a device that is providing maybe some useful service. Maybe that service is useful only for that network. We can't really tell, but it's highly powerful. It has high bandwidth, high computational capacity, so it receives packets, spoofed packets, and of course it sends a response to the victim, and everyone else can't really access the victim. So what are the two problems? Spoofing and reflector or amplifier in the internet. So why the capacity? And we don't really know how impactful DOS attacks can be at the moment. we don't really know, besides quantity-wise, who is contributing, from where, what kind of device, what kind of protocols. We don't really know what is happening to capacity. We see trend, the attacks are increasing, but I can't tell you the capacity at this point in time. And we have decision makers. If you are network administrator, you want to know, do I need to buy something? Do I need to buy service? Can I survive it anyways? If you are manager, you want to know what to invest here. And most importantly, we have a lot of top level decision makers in this conference, and they want to act upon knowledge and information. And a good decision maker would ask, what is current capacity, what is predicted, and of course, he or she would ask somebody to find the answer. And what is the answer? Reality is the only kind of public answer, if we are not going into like intelligence side. It's there are companies that publishing success stories. Okay, we mitigated that. Of course, they don't publish failed stories. And these numbers are also not good. These numbers happened once in historical point of time, in specific network, a specific attack. None of these numbers are relevant for the protocol today. And what is happening research-wise? There are maybe a dozen approaches for DoS research. And starting from motivation, from financial, and ending with testing solutions, applying machine learning, and everything else that science offers at the moment, just to make it work better. Sadly, the capacity research is quite limited. There is a single academical paper by Leverett and colleagues who use specific data sets, and they took average speeds and multiplied by reflector count, and that is their number. They applied some other limitations, but still, it's their number. And they ended up with 100 plus terabits per second capacity. It's a lot. There is a research institution, Cybergreen Project. They assign risks to the different countries, different machines that have reflectors, so it's a bit different approach, but can it really be done better? And so the answer to the question, why it's happening, and I think it's because there is insufficient knowledge about the capacity and reality. And to fix that, we need to get there, to solve the issue. And I'm going to present my approach, how I think we should solve the issue. And I think we can measure the devices, because I just told, they just multiply some existing sets. And if you look at the methodology, what we need to do? We need to identify abusable protocols, which is quite easy. We know which protocols are being abused. And if new protocol starts to being abused, it will be big news. So new information is coming from outside. We don't have to really do anything. Scan those on the internet. And there are quite a lot of scanning projects for different protocols, different purposes, and most of them end here on the red line. So they don't really investigate what's happening further. And we can do that. We can look if every individual device on the internet actually is answering something that is larger in size, something that can be abused. We can see if the device stops answering after a few requests. And we can combine this information into some single number and see what is the reality there. And for proof of concept, I looked at two quite old protocols, but they are somewhat different. They represent somewhat like two different categories. Both of them are quite old, but for NTP, maybe it was 4 or 5 years ago, it was huge spike, which took maybe 3 months to drop down and to be somewhat remediated. If you look at DNS, it has been abused almost 20 years. So you would expect it to be kind of remediated faster. Also, for NTP, the feature is the bug feature, so it does not really need it. So if we get rid of it, everything is fine. For DNS, you're abusing the protocol itself. So let's look at NTP. It's just time servers, and monolist was the command that is abused. It's just the bug feature. It returns recent client list. So I have had like 100 clients, and then administrator can debug, okay, these machines are synchronizing and these machines are not synchronizing. That's pretty much all. And if you send only 16 byte request, you get 100 packets, up to 100 packets back. So amplification is 4,000, something huge. And that was the largest DOS attacks in 2014, early winter. So it's about above 400 gigabits peaked. So what can we see if we look at rate limit? We see some very suspicious spikes at very round numbers that humans would use. And if we see that indeed the services that are currently on the internet, they are rate limited. So they can't really be abused if you just look at the number. And why? There are mitigation efforts. There is software fixes. There are updates. There are networking filters for DOS on the transit level, on the network level. So stuff is happening. But an attacker would like, which has access to small botnet or some other way how to spoof IP, the attacker would like to look at zero rate limits, zero packet loss. And what is estimations today? And today estimations are quite poor. So let's take number of found devices, multiply by maximum amplification without any rate limiting, without anything. So that is quite worthless number in my opinion. After we see rate limit, we can look at response size. And if we look at the highest data points, they are quite okay. The amplification is present, but an attacker would like to have 1,000 time amplification, not like 10 times. So this is already limiting. So I can tell by the size of botnet what is the estimated size of attack it can cause. Somewhat more estimations than measuring in botnet size, botnet cases. And after we see rate limit, after we see response sizes, we might come to conclusion that we don't need any more information. And turns out this is also wrong, because a lot of devices are ridiculously slow, network-wise. And they might be embedded. Maybe they don't have processing power. Maybe they have processing power. So we don't really know what is the reason. And we don't really actually care what's the reason. We are measuring from the victim side. Victim doesn't care why the size of the attack is what's coming back. And it peaks around 5 kilobits per second. So 5 kilobits is like 1/10 of dial-up speed. So it's nothing. The contribution, if you combine it with rate limits and other stuff, the contribution is so insignificant that if attacker uses these machines, he likely is losing resources, not gaining the attack capacity. On the other side, if you look at the other side, we have small number of outliers. We have small number of servers in data centers connected to gigabit or 10 gigabit connections that can push hundreds of megabits per each. So smart attacker would pick something from here. He would compare rate limiting, and with minimal resources would gain maximum attack he can get from what's available to him. Another metric we can look at round trip time. And if we see there is again huge spike about 1 second, there is nothing two times around the globe. These are super low power, super inefficient, wirelessly connected devices that contribute almost nothing. They are really not important in any way. And let's look at count. And if you look, USA is number one, China number two, Brazil number three, and Spain is number four, just count-wise. And does it correspond to the attack capacity? And partially. So if you look at attack capacity, that China produces the biggest. And what happened? US still produces something. The Russia has appeared, the France has appeared, but Spain is almost gone to zero from number four. So what's happening? Turns out the type of devices that are common in Spain, they are just some kind of wireless connectivity devices which contribute nothing to the overall capacity. So we should not care about that. We should not care that there is something wrong in Spain. We should care that something wrong in China. And how the capacity is measured, so because it's so small, I did not go into detail for limiting it. I just looked for about dial-up speeds, and the number is 134 gigabits, which is it's a very low and boring number. So let's look to the next protocol, which provides something much more interesting. And DNS, as I mentioned, it's default protocol functionality. DNS by default uses UDP, so you send a request, and it will send response to anyone with the source IP you sent. And open resolvers. If you look at the statistics, there were maybe 30 million a few years ago. Now I tested 13 million, so almost three times less. And it has some difference. So it supports different functionality. It supports lesser and larger sizes. So if you look at rate limit, there is extremely obvious that huge number of DNS servers are rate limited. So this is an old issue, and this issue has been fixed in many, many cases. Like if you look some 10, 20, 25, there is requests per second, that is the spikes where the rate limit is extremely obvious. And so what are the sizes? And as we can see, the sizes are not so good from attacker's perspective, that most majority of the devices provide very, very standard and small response. But still, this is interesting for research purposes, as this is not supporting the ADNS, so it's a newer feature. So this might be all embedded small home routers and devices of this type of class. So what happens if we look at the capacity of DNS? Still we see China, still we see Russia, United States, we see Indonesia. So we see mostly Asian countries, and their capacity is growing, so they have much bigger problems. And if we limit the obvious rate limit at 30, if we get rid of dial-up, so only maybe 12% of all, that is something I would consider as a huge or significant contributor. And the number of 37 terabits is already much more interesting and already much more mattering in the world scale. And so the next challenge would be total capacity, because we know that networks have finite upload capacity, and it is quite hard to determine it, because it is, okay, you can determine public peering capacity, you don't know what's private, so it's very hard to determine upload capacity. So the easier way at the moment is just, if the devices overlap, take the most contributing protocol and use that. And the sets were small, so overlap is very small, so total capacity of these two protocols is still 37 terabits. And so what could be the conclusion? That of course bandwidth is much more important than Zen count, so we don't really care about the counts that much. Rate limiting really is something that is already present extremely commonly, and we should filter those out as insignificant. We have slow devices, we have slow networks, we just filter them out and ignore them. And of course, it's common knowledge, Asia, poor network management, China, Indonesia, Thailand, so that is a problematic region. And if you have slow networks like Africa and most of the South America, the contribution is very, very close to zero. But still Europe, if you look at some cheaper data centers, which we have a lot in Europe, they don't really care that much about the preventative measures, and they still contribute at least to the long-term protocols. And so the lack of regulation seems to be the main issue. And we have heard California doing something for IT devices. We have heard Europe. So they can demand devices to have some security, and they're doing that. Same way they can demand devices not have open reflectors to look into the internet. And it's a software issue, so manufacturer is not going to make vulnerable and unvulnerable. They will make one version that can be sold in Europe and USA, so it will fix problem in many regions. And what are the challenges? And the challenges are quite a lot of technical challenges, a lot of estimation challenges. Does my estimates correspond to the real world? It's hard to answer question. The order of magnitude seems to be okay. How can we limit the capacity contributions per network? And it's a question that does not have a good answer. We have ethics and liability. But the most important, how to reach hearing ears? So we come up with a number, and how can I present this number in a way that that somebody that can make change happen, how can I cause maximum impact in that scenario? And I have seen different approaches, but I don't know if any of them actually work. Maybe we need to somehow measure them. Thank you.
Thank you, Artus. Are there any questions?
Hi. Why did you use NTP and DNS for your talk?
It's a proof of concept. So of course, I am planning to do it for all the common protocols. But as I mentioned, they are somewhat different of the way how they were abused. So I wanted to see. And I think most of the protocols can fall in one or the other class. And I wanted to see that it is working in both scenarios. So it was just pick, just to see the proof of concept.
OK, I would suggest you take PortMapper, port 111, as next one.
Thank you for the question. Are there any more questions, maybe also from the other speakers? No? Anyone? Okay. Arthur, you mentioned that a lot of institutions actually do research the capacity in the field, or like at least that there are other researchers out there doing the same. Could malicious actors or parties actually use such a research as well to like infect the right machines to actually like have the biggest capacity? As you said at the very end, the conclusion was, I think, quantity doesn't matter. Quality is the key here. So, how would you say, like, could malicious actors maybe also research on that and just like go for those machines?
Yeah, and there were a lot of graphs, and every time I said as a malicious party, I would do that, and maybe they do. And some years ago, I looked into that, and it's very hard to differentiate. Is it a measuring or is it actually? There are so many different people, and there are so many unprofessional dossers that they're spoiling data set. I mean, malicious parties are spoiling my data sets. Yes, that is the issue. And because if you look at like other research, there are even like script kiddies like causing DOS attacks against like gamers. Just their network connection allows to spoof packets. They just launch script and just attack other gamers, and that looks like kind of something small that could be measuring, but it also could be a real DOS attack. So it's problematic, but good attackers would definitely do that, but I am not sure if like state level malicious parties would do DOS attacks. I don't think they care about that. They have much, much better things to do, and if the system is running, they are much more happier than when it's down.
Thank you. Are there maybe any more questions? Otherwise, I have another one. So just going back to like why you did the proof of concept, what is the main advantage from your point of perspective? I know it's like somehow biased because like you wrote the paper to actually prove a point here, to prove the concept, but what is the main advantage, or what are the main advantages to the other research, research already published or like ongoing in the field?
So if you look at not academic stuff, then it's very standard. There is protocols, you scan them, you put them on the list, you publish them, and then sometimes they just send mail to everyone, to all the contact network contacts, and sometimes the providers forward emails, and sometimes they feel they have done something. And I mentioned DNS stuff, so it was 30 million like 5-7 years ago. And they were sending emails, and I have gotten quite a lot of emails because I was running honeypots. So I know that everyone gets emails. I know that some people get them even forwarded. But can we really measure the impact? And did their work actually make the world better? And I don't know how to answer that, and they also don't know how to answer. Maybe we need to measure. So maybe we need to do this in more real-time setting with more detailed understanding. And maybe if there is some kind of miracle happens, some legislative approach, let's make device sold in European Union certified, not obviously vulnerable or abusable, maybe we can see that something is shrinking. Maybe we can see impact, and maybe that impact can be kind of fuel for next actions.
Well, thank you very much, Artus. We will keep on going with Commander Dr. Robert Koch. Before I introduce you and also your topic, I would like to say, so we have heard now from our two first speakers about like more noisy attacks and very much, well, rather easy to spot. Now we're going to go over, and I don't want to spoil your paper, but now we're going to go over to the more silent side of things, where hidden attacks are and how we can detect them, which of course hopefully fits also the theme of the conference as like silent battle, and I hope you can relate to that, as it is also standing in your title, which is Silent Battles Towards Unmasking Hidden Cyber Attacks. And just to introduce Robert, even though he has been on the stage several times already and also today, just before the lunch break, I hope you had time to eat something, since you will have to struggle with us here a little bit. So Robert is a general staff officer of the Federal Armed Forces. He holds a diploma in computer science, received his PhD in 2011, and his habilitation in 2017. Now he is a senior research assistant and lecturer in computer science at the University, Universität der Bundeswehr and the University of Bonn. His main areas of research are network and system security, with focus on intrusion detection in encrypted networks, security of COTS products, security visualization, and the application of artificial intelligence. Currently, he is building up the new penetration testing capability at the Cyber Center of the Federal Armed Forces. And he's currently my boss as well there. But Robert, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. We are now going from the noisy attacks down to the silent part, trying to get new ideas how to identify what else is maybe going on out there, but much more difficult to identify. Everybody is well aware about the ubiquity of the IT nowadays. So everyday life is entangled from office work over telecommunications to the financial sector, and nothing is working without IT, of course. Naturally, that's very attractive for cyber criminals too. We have a very high economic potential in there, and also based on the very complex structures of the internet and the system itself, we have regular vulnerabilities. Also, the opportunity to at least partially achieve anonymity in the internet. So a lot of attractive aspects for cyber criminals to do some bad stuff there, and also the prosecution can be quite lengthy internationally, even if the crimes are detected. To have an idea about the numbers, it's quite difficult to estimate the damage that's going on. There's a nice tool called Cyber Risk Calculator presented by RAND. You can play around a little bit with the parameters to get an idea what the losses may be. And McAfee updated their study on the losses in the cyber area, the global losses last year, and getting a number about 600 billion worldwide a year at the moment of the financial losses in the area. So really a bad number. Why is the estimation so difficult? Yeah, of course, often companies may not report some incidents, even they realize them, because they fear reputational loss or something else. But quite often, they will just don't know it. They don't detect it, or only after a very long time. So the basic question we are looking for is, do some cyber attacks remain hidden, even though they have a very significant impact? That means something happened in the world, and maybe there is a cyber attack behind it, and we just don't know it. So could be could have another reason, but maybe it was a cyber attack, and we just didn't realize it. So what could be silent in the domain? If you have a look at the traditional domain to the military, of course Clausewitz has to be mentioned here, and his concept of war, he says, we require relative superiority. And in going a little bit back in time to Sun Tzu, he also said surprising actions lead to victory, so we can have silence as a prerequisite for surprise, and that's a prerequisite for superiority. Having a look at the cyber domain, of course the cyber domain is virtual and more silent per se, so normally we are adding noise with our actions. And for example, DDoS is a very important example, because that is really noisy. And you can have a look what what's the reason for doing a DDoS, and of course that may be just hiding the real attack. So make some noise, distract the guys working on security, and do the actual attack somewhere in the background. Kaspersky identified 2015 that 74% of all attacks are DDoS attacks are that nature, so covering the actual attack. But data can be very different. Also, it's a couple of years later, so the mindset may be changed of the attackers. So last year, Verizon presented a report where they said, it is often said, but not so easy to prove, like alien visitation covered by the government, often said in some domains at least, but not so easy to prove, because in their data sets, they only realized a single DDoS attack, and it was not covering another attack, but an attack was done to initiate the DDoS attack. So completely the way around, and no traces of some DDoS attacks covering other attacks. In the cybersecurity landscape, we now have to identify what can we see. We have quite good reports from different companies on a regular base because they have huge sensor networks. Think, for example, about endpoint protection of antivirus companies. So they have a quite good picture what's going on out there. But you have to think about their viewpoints. So it can be, like in the interpretation of the DDoS attacks, quite different what is the outcome. A good aspect, the perception of the threat, the awareness in the companies is nowadays quite good. Everybody is aware that cyber attacks are a problem, but in real world, we still have a very big problem with strategically addressing that trouble. The industry and especially the operational technology parts are a good example. So a study from Kaspersky in 2018 showed that only 23% of the companies are compliant with the minimal mandatory industry and government regulations. So there's still a lot to do. Everybody is aware about the problem, but the steps are not taken yet, especially not on a strategic level. And also, for more than 70% of the company's cyber attacks still in the year 2018 are kind of a mystery. So they say we do not know how they will affect us or when will they come. So it's still really, really difficult to identify these kind of attacks. Even the situation is worse, it's getting more worse because the detection is becoming more challenging as it's more and more outside of the control of the victims. In 2018, we could identify a sharp increase in third and fourth party attacks based on the supply chain. And that's normally not in the reach within the company, so the detection is much harder because of that. And also things in January 2018, for example, Spectre and Meltdown were published, a lot of media attention, and everybody was waiting for patches, and it's quite difficult, sometimes impossible, to do patches by software to hardware vulnerabilities. So some of the cyber criminals were quite clever and took that opportunity, that window, to prepare some fake updates, and presenting their malware, saying, okay, it's a patch for the vulnerability, and everybody, not everybody fortunately, but some guys were installing that stuff, and thinking they will close down a vulnerability, but in real world it was exploited. And it's much more easy to just use a current malware and push it by a fake patch to a system than exploiting a new vulnerability, like for example the Spectre stuff. What do we also know? For example, we have quite a good view what's going on from the Snowden documents, of course. Technically, there was nothing surprising within these documents, only the dimension of the surveillance was quite impressive, so the infiltration of all layers from the software over the hardware and firmware up to the algorithms. Even more interesting, not so well known, but even more interesting is the Vault 7 and Vault 8 breach. And for example, we talked a lot about attribution these days and that we are making progress. And I think in the political domain, that's very important. It's sometimes taken too easy on the technical level. Some companies are very fast with bringing out some ideas of attribution, who has done what. And for example, the Marble framework, which you can find in the Vault 7 leaks, is exactly for the purpose to prepare a false attribution. So changing the code in a way that it's like someone else did it, changing, like in the example, the languages which are used within the product. So especially a program crafted to ease the false attribution a little bit. And then, of course, we have quite a number of incidents which were analyzed really well. For example, the power outages in Ukraine in the December 2015 and 2016, where we can clearly see that was just testing what is possible, especially with the second one in December 2016 in another part of Kiev. That was not the aim to bring down the power grid for a long time and make chaos, just to try what is possible in the field. You can realize that very well if you go into the details of these attacks. So some guys are really preparing the battlefield with attacks like these. What else can we expect? From a technical point of view, a lot is possible, of course, and you have talked and to talk about the probability that we will find it in real world. A very important aspect in that very famous discussion is about hardware backdoors. There are nice papers out there, for of course, for example, implementing on a microcoded base backdoor into an AMD processor. Very nice work, because it's a backdoor in the processor, and you can easily activate it by some stuff over the web, because you can initiate just a calculation that is opening the backdoor. Very nice paper. In 2012, we had the backdoor in the Microsemi Pro ASICS reprocessor, and in the respective discussion, is it a backdoor or not? And of course, in October last year, very famous, after the Bloomberg Business Week announcement, the big hack was the title, that there are tiny microchips implanted into some boards from Supermicro. That opened up the discussion again, and it was interesting how immediate and vehement the contradiction of the named companies and institution was. I think that's not too trustworthy. At least one should give a little time to analyze some stuff. There's one interesting analysis available from a university in the UK, which are taking up the rare technical details, and it can be done exactly the way it was described. So technically, it's possible. Huawei and 5G, we are well known about the discussion. And these possible threats are much more possible in real world if you combine that with the supply chain attacks we can see the past years, and attacks on the industrial critical infrastructure, steering systems, and the critical infrastructure. So a high risk. So now we can ask why detection in that area quite often fails. If you want to analyze an attacker and the required steps, you can take some means, like for example kill chains. And Lockheed Martin proposed the so-called cyber kill chain quite a time ago, very famous one. And the different attack steps are presented here. And the idea is that the adversary must complete all of these steps to achieve their objectives. And if you analyze the different steps, you can try to set up different detection mechanisms and try to identify the attacker as early as possible and stop him. There are other models available, for example, for Mitre with sometimes different steps and different focus, but quite similar in the from the basic mindset behind it. So why are these kill chains not able to identify sophisticated attacks? Well, companies, for example, can overlook, of course, indicators, or not being able to look for them. Think about, for example, that several targets are inflicted with one attack, and they just can't identify the indicators from a specific step. And I think a very good example is thinking about the supply chain attack. Again, because in that area, the regular attack chain, kill chain, is even faulty, because you don't need steps 1, 2, 3, and depending on the kind of vulnerability you bring in into the systems by the supply chain, even up to step 6 is not required. You can do, if you do it the right way, going directly to the action somewhere in the field, and prepare everything else before, and in a way that it's not observable by the target. So that's the difficult stuff about applying the supply chain in real world for sophisticated attacks. So how to make progress in that area? I quite often use a vulnerability model with 3 layers. On the lowest layer, we have the exploitation of known vulnerabilities. So for example, the stuff you can find on the common vulnerabilities and exposures. So it's publicly known, and a good defense should be normally available, but in in real world, yeah, we have aspects like poor system maintenance and things like that, but it's more complicated. Think about challenges that we have a lot of products after their end of life, especially in the industrial sector. Systems are running sometimes for decades, 24/7, and it's very difficult to update these systems in the medical area, in the area of airplanes and stuff. You require recertifications even if you only want to patch a system, so it's much more difficult. And if you have a look at the famous WannaCry attacks, the patches for the system were out, but only for the supported system of Microsoft Windows, and all the system affected, Windows XP and Surface 2003, that are the stuff in the control area and critical infrastructure, and it's running for very, very long times. In layer two, that's about finding new vulnerabilities. So the typical zero day, nobody knows. You can use different techniques to reach that goal, like code analysis and reverse engineering. And these vulnerabilities can have a very different value, down from a few dollars if it's not an important software, or the vulnerability is not really powerful. Not everything gives you a full remote system access, but it can go up to 2 million at the moment if it's really a powerful stuff. And companies like Zerodium are dealing with these things. And we also see an increasing role of so-called one days, so that are vulnerabilities just publicly known, so everybody knows about it, but the patches, maybe the disclosure process was not going the right way, or there is some trouble, or you have just some delay in the installation process, so there's a small window of opportunity of a few days where the vulnerability is known and the patch is not installed, and that's the best time to take over a system with very low-hanging fruits. There's an interesting report from CrowdStrike, and they analyzed that Russian hackers in average only require at the moment about 18 minutes to take over a network. And by that means, using these techniques, that's no problem, of course. The third layer, introducing new vulnerabilities. So that's the best one because it presents you an assured access combined with a normally quite low detection risk. So on that layer, very difficult to implement, but there we are talking about intentionally introduced vulnerabilities that are often or typically also not known to the vendor. A good example is the dual elliptical curve algorithm, where the NSA introduced a kleptographic backdoor, very nice work from a mathematical point of view, or of course again talking about backdoor functionality in chips. And the complexity of the today's supply chain makes these attacks easier, but the number of players who are able to do that are fortunately quite limited. So what about the detection opportunities? Nowadays, of course, we have big challenges based on the large and increasing amounts of data we have to analyze and the complexity of the systems and the speed in cyberspace. So you require a very high degree of automation. But typically, a lot of sophisticated attack vectors are still quite bad to identify by automated means. So also, the evaluation is quite data-centric. For example, we use a lot of signatures, heuristics, flows, for example, NetFlow and S-Flow evaluations, behavior of connections, and things like that. And that's fine for identifying the layer one attacks, which are the biggest amount of attacks, but still it's not enough to have a look for more sophisticated ones. So what can we do? We have to integrate other elements, because the important aspect is with a sophisticated attack, there is stuff going on that's not running on the wire. For example, think about social engineering attacks, but in the original sense of Kevin Mitnick's several decades ago, that's not doing a spear phishing attack with an email, that's going in there and talking with the guys and getting the access credentials. That's not on the wire, you will not detect it, and it's much tougher challenge to introduce that into an analysis process. So our approach is to somehow enrich the data that has to be examined, for example, also changing detection thresholds, but not going into the details about that. And for example, adding external sources like, for example, how are the prices changing on the three-day market? What are the talks on Twitter with respect to security? And using that knowledge to enrich the process. And based on that, building a 3D detection model that is combining the traditional cyber kill chains with a vulnerability model, and the third vector would be the time, and based on some behavior rules thinking, how may a sophisticated attacker move through these different layers? There will be a picture in a second. So based on some behavior rules, I present here two, the rest is in the paper. For example, you can think about that a sophisticated attacker is more willing to use a 0-day that he bought from another company than using his own one, and he's more willing to deploy a 0-day the older it is, because a 0-day has also a half-life, a lifetime. There's a nice report from RAND Corporation out there for that. It's called 0 Days, 1,000 Nights, talking a little bit about the lifetime of these 0-days. So based on these lemmatas, I'm trying to identify which steps the attacker will do. Of course, knowing the lemmata, the attacker may try to adapt. The good aspect is there should be some non-controllable side effects who are not changeable by the attacker, so that should be still detectable. So think about he wants to do a more sophisticated attack, needs a new 0-day, and is buying a 0-day on the gray market. Then we can try to identify these actions, maybe in changed market prices and stuff like that. And based on that, every layer of the vulnerability model gets a corresponding cyber kill chain specifically prepared for the layer, and a transition matrix is going to identify these steps. So you can put these chains onto the model, and you see I highlighted only two steps in gray because they are not required on that normal meaning for the layer 3, but you have to adapt the cyber kill chains, the means behind it, in different ways for each of the layer. And the matrix and the model behind it is now trying to identify by calculations of the probability of transitions between the model if some actions are related to identify is something going on in cyberspace. So remember the question, we have a lot of data and there was an incident and we want to try to find out may it have a cyber reason in the background. The problem now at the moment is to proceed, we need a lot of real-world data. So that's also a call. If someone is interested in cooperation, then talk to me afterwards. So we are interested to move the model forward, but that's quite difficult at the moment. So to sum it up, the fundamental question of our research at the moment here is, do some cyber attacks remain hidden? Even they have a significant impact in the real world, and the reasons why detection fails is that traditional models like the cyber kill chain are not able to detect several steps because they are just not on the wire. So we try to extend the current models based on a combination of the vulnerability model and the cyber kill chains and extend the knowledge that is used to try to identify by mathematical means these correlations in the background based on the highlighted behavior rules and some risk calculations. As I said, the biggest challenge at the moment is we need some good data sets, and the perfect data set for us would be something long running over a long time where a cyber attack has been, but which was only identified after a quite long time. So if you can provide that, of course everything will be anonymous and we will care about data, regulation rules and everything, but that would be the perfect help for us to bring the work forward. The first prototype is only focusing on retroactively identifying if there was a hidden cyber attack. Of course, if we are able to work better on the different indicators and move forward, the ultimate goal is to identify campaigns that are ongoing and running. So trying if we can put up as many knowledge from these models to identify the campaigns even when they are ongoing. So there are much more details in the paper. Everybody is invited to read it, and you can also come back with the topic or data sets, of course, later to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Robert. Are there any questions? Well, I think you shocked everybody a little bit. No? Yeah. The microphone's coming. Just hold on a second.
Okay, I'm not an expert of cybersecurity and buyer, so procurement aside. So I acquiring services for and tools for cybersecurity. I think what is important, what you told, that the future maybe is about hardware, chip, backdoor, and so on. Because in the last 20 years, the focus on cybersecurity was on the software. Mm. I think they knew the future would be that a lot of attack could arrive from the chip or the, some system installed in chip. So the hardware is the future, I suppose, of cybersecurity, because at the moment it's empty space, no one cares about. I know some industry that work about, and this is very interesting what you told.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Is there a question maybe? Oh, I think you really chucked them all. They all want coffee. anyways, you combined the three layer vulnerability model and the cyber kill chain. Could you elaborate? I know it's like a little bit more detailed in your paper, in the book, but could you maybe take a minute or two to explain, like, is it synchronized, and like, how is it synchronized, and like, what comes out of it?
Interesting question. Don't take the picture wrong, because everything is in a straight line from the different cyber kill chains and the different layers. They are completely unsynchronized. So the speed can be different, how they evolve, and think about an attacker. If it's a sophisticated attack, you may initiate different processes in parallel. So you try to use the common vectors first. If there's no operational risk, that you are forced to use higher ones already in the beginning. And maybe you are preparing, but also an attack opportunity on layer two, then it can start both to the same time. But it can happen that you're trying to use the non-valuable attack vectors first. And after identifying, OK, it's not working the way I want, starting the next one. So you have to keep that into mind. And that doesn't allow a good synchronization of these lines, only finding out if you can, to some point in time, synchronize different steps. So it's a lot of correlation. But never forget, correlation does not imply causation. So you must be careful with the interpretation of the results. So now they are not synchronized, but the main focus is to identify the elements and put them back to the timeline. So you can say, OK, the attacker is doing that now, and really identify the attack as a whole.
Well, thank you very much, Robert. So to wrap up the session really quick, as you have heard, we had three speakers. Two of them had a paper, have a paper in this nice proceeding book. Please check them out. I think they are the last two, if I remember correctly. They're really interesting to read, and you might be able to read some more about the matters, as like the presenters didn't have enough time to probably say everything. Otherwise, I would like to thank all of you. thank you for coming here, and thank you for having us, CCDCUE. It was a pleasure. And as you could see, you could even combine noisy attacks and silent attacks, because at least until 2015, it was predicted that they actually have something in common. Thank you very much.